the connection between kinship making and online community, I think started because I'm based in Scandinavia, and about a decade and a half ago, we had this like baby boom because our legislation was changed. So it was allowed for lesbian couples, queer couples, and single women to reproduce on the state. So to go to the fertility clinic and get help with fertility. We saw what we can call social media, so Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, become everyday practices. And there was a lot of scholarship going into the social media, and there was a lot of scholarship going into kinship making because we had all this new kinship. And in people's life, these two fields were really connected. You know, people were literally connecting up on social media, finding sperm donors on social media, and yet the research really did not connect these two areas. And I was very interested in, can we look at social media actually not simply as a technology, but as a reproduction technology? So my work is around seeing social media not simply as something that facilitates contact, but actually a technology of reproduction that contributes quite literally to making new types of kinship. Some of the things I'll touch upon is how parents who have children who are donor conceived, so children made with the help of donor sperm or donor eggs, connect with each other online, both to form a community, but also to find what is sometimes called donor siblings. So children who have the same sperm donor as your child has. I'll also be talking about how families are cultivated through photo sharing. So this everyday practice of taking pictures of your child, sharing it, just uploading it, sharing it with them, with other parents in these extended kinship networks. I'm very occupied with trying to provide people voice. So talking to, I call them queer parents. So parents who are not forming families in the traditional nuclear straight family setting, but other kinds of families, providing them voice, not judging them, giving them a chance to explain why they do what they do and how they do it. And I think that's quite important because research within what we can call alternative families is very often, you know, either about proving that the alternative families are doing equally well as straight nuclear families, or about talking about how they all experience discrimination. Junior scholars, but also for senior scholars. I think what is really important in our research is to be open to surprises and always let the material surprise you. Because I also think that's where we actually get new insights. Be open to this ambivalence, but also to see, you know, because I think often we tend to be like, this is only bad or this is only good, but actually be more open to that it can be both, and then it can be ambivalent and contradictory. If we think of my field as kind of like the entanglement of kinship and social media, I think the future will be influenced quite a lot by both more and more people reproducing with reproductive technologies, but also that these platforms such as Facebook become increasingly criticized. And we need to, as researchers, be part of that criticism, but I also think maybe some of the communities I've documented, maybe they will move away from these big platforms as Facebook. So I think we would see, hopefully, maybe a more plural landscape of platforms, but definitely something about not everyone gathering on the same platforms in the future. I think there's some work to be done in what would that landscape then look like, and we don't know yet.